Alright, hello and welcome everyone here to the Join Dota League America Season 3. We've got a two-game series coming up. This is going to be the beginning of Game 1. We're in the draft. Sneaky Nick's Assassins going up against Union Gaming Peru, who managed to pause the game while it was loading and led to quite a bit of confusion, thus the big span of silence and chirping in-game Dota birds. But here we are, we're finally ready to go. I'm Helium, and with me is Gorgon. Maybe Gorgon is with me.
There we go. Now you can hear me, I bet.
Ah, there
all's well that ends well. The pause threw me off. Yeah, thanks for having me. It's nice to be here again on JDL. I feel like we're here almost every day these days, it feels like. We're here an awful lot.
Yeah, Season 3 is finally seems to be in full swing. There's quite a few games earlier today. There's a game now, obviously. There's games later. We got games tomorrow. There's like 6 games on Wednesday, another 2 on Thursday, and there's more popping up all the time as the schedule gets made. So there's a lot of action over here, and it's great fun, and so we love to cover it for you guys. But we can look at some of the bans here. First ban out looks to have been Razor was banned first, followed by the Tide, and then we've got a Doom taken out there. So I don't know if you want to touch on any of those heroes, maybe someone newer to Dota. Why are some of those heroes banned?
Well, the Razor and the Doombringer are specifically being banned because of their popularity right now. They came in, Doom for the last 3 to 4 months has been a hero who has been selected very frequently due to the strength of his flexibility through the mid game, and also the fact that he has this giant mute, which not only is a silence, but it also stops you from being able to use passives. It also stops you from being able to use items. So it's very effective up against strong timing teams and teams that are dependent on either passives or item effects, which was pretty much every team about 3 months ago. It was just in meta. Everybody was trying to get those early things like Sheepsix or Necronomicons and really get in for these strong push strategies. And Doom kind of shuts that down if you can pick one hero out with that Doom and then move in on a 5-on-4.
Yeah, especially back not too long ago where it was popular to just have a single core hero on your team, and Doom really shut that down. He is pretty much the counter to everything, and there's not much you can do to really counter him. And again, you mentioned it, his versatility early on in the game. Going to about any lane, he can get a ton of gold regardless just because of Devour, his built-in skill, which should maybe cost more mana. We'll see. You can't really nerf his ultimate Doom, or no one would ever play him.
Right.
So he's in an interesting place. He's definitely not unbeatable, but he's not very fun to play against, so people just take him out. Tidehunter, fantastic offlaner. You never want to give it away to the Dire, because now that his Anchor Smash hits the Ancients, Tide, even if he's a support, can roll down later, clear out a stack at around level 5, level 7, and he'll have pretty big items. I mean, it's not uncommon to see refresher Tidehunters in any game now with the Shivas as well as a mech and a blink potentially at like the 40 minute mark even. And the double Ravage is very strong. Lycan, of course, same thing. It's a Dire targeted ban. They don't want to give away the Lycan that allows for early split push and early Roche attempts. Sneaky Nyx Assassin is the team that loves the early Roche and have a hero that they can do that with. Now the Shadow Shaman picked up first, then Union Gaming, Brewmaster, Skywrath Mage.
Okay, so the Skywrath Mage pickup along with the Brewmaster tells me that we might be looking at a Faceless Void offlane for Union Gaming. Faceless Void pairs very well with the Skywrath Mage and also actually pairs pretty well with the Brewmaster, because when Brewmaster starts to fall off, that's really when an offlane Faceless Void starts to get going. So there's a nice smooth transition period between the mid-Brewmaster and the offlane Faceless. We'll see if Sneaking Assassins picks up on that, if they want to ban that hero out, or if they're not really that frightened of it. But it does seem like, with the current meta, that is probably where Union Gaming is going. For Sneaky Nyx Assassins, no surprises. They pick up the Shadow Shaman. They'll probably go for a more heavily push-oriented strategy. Maybe a 4 protect 1 semi off those pushes. They like to be very active in the early game, typically. Out of American teams, they're probably the most well-known for being extremely active through the early game.
Yeah, I'd expect a Viper pickup here from Sneaky Nyx Assassins. I mean, Brewmaster and Skywrath have a ton of magic damage early on, and who do you pick up? Generally, in that case, you pick up Viper because he's got the corrosive skin built in. He's not going to be so fragile to the Skywrath, but instead they're going to go for some big silence. That's going to help mitigate the Brewmaster ultimate, his mid-game performance, as long as the global silence is up. If Brewmaster can't split, then he's really not that great of a hero. I mean, he does good damage with his clap and then usually the guaranteed crit afterwards. And Skywrath won't be able to do anything. He is actually useless if he can't spam out his first ability, the Arcane Bolt, and hopefully hit someone with a Mystic Flare. But Silencer, a little more interesting of a pick, and it is something that gets banned out in the second phase a lot, just because of the big wombo combo team compositions that are very popular right now, but it'll be interesting.
Yeah, Silencer is an interesting pick, just because, once again, we've talked about this recently, but for anybody who hasn't been watching the JDL cast, Silencer is a hero that there's a lot of disagreement about the proper way to play him at this level of play. There's a lot of disagreement about whether or not you should try to cast that silence before an engagement starts or right after it starts. Try to get it before anybody can cast anything and maybe waste a second or two of that silence as an initiation, or try to use it as a counter initiation. And whether or not you stagger that by 1 or 2 seconds can literally mean make or break in a team fight. So it's very difficult spell to cast well.
And it has a big cooldown, so if you mess up, then you're kind of vulnerable for, what is it actually going to be? We can look at it. 130 seconds, so just a little over 2 minutes, you're vulnerable to some push, and that's where those wombo combo teams in general kind of fall apart. Like, if you've used your black hole and your ravage, well, then the other team is just going to push in and take as much as they can off the map, because you can't really fight. But we do see the void. You said that maybe Union would want it. They'll actually ban it out themselves.
That's interesting. And I'm really surprised to see Nature's Prophet Lone Druid bans Command Sneak Necessus. Neither of those heroes are very popular right now, partially because both of those heroes have the potential to feed in a lot of gold even without dying, thanks to the Treants and the Spirit Bear, respectively. Spirit Bear gives a huge bounty, and the Treants give about half as much as a normal melee creep, but because you're calling them in lane very frequently, you end up giving your opponents quite a bit of gold if they're last hitting them.
Yeah, indeed. It's not heroes that Union Gaming plays often, though. I think you did mention that when you started off. I would expect maybe an Earthshaker or a Sand King coming out from Union Gaming. Maybe not as their third pick, but as a support. I mean, Skywrath, he does well with Earthshaker, obviously. The Fissure into a Mystic Flare anytime once they're level 6 is... Well, once Sky's level 6, Earthshaker could be level 1. It doesn't really matter. There's a ton of burst damage potential there. Good team fight, but they'll go with the Bristle back, who seems very vulnerable to the mana drain and the silence of Silencer. Like, if this hero can't constantly cast his spells to build up his, I think it's called Warpath. Yeah, it is called Warpath. Then he's useless. So, interesting. And he's not really a BKB hero.
But bear in mind that Bristleback, something that he is going to be able to do is just sustain fights. And when you do have a Brewmaster who's going to be silenced through a portion of these fights, you're going to need to buy time for the Brewmaster to be able to get his split off. And Bristleback is an excellent time-buying hero, just because he's so difficult to kill. He runs around spamming out. Even if he's not spamming it out, his Quill Spray just naturally spams out. So, but because of his Bristleback, which automatically casts Quill Spray after a certain amount of damage, I think it's 250 from rear and sides or something like that.
It's 250 from the rear when the passive shoots out the spray.
Right, so he's already just implicitly spraying out damage. I don't know how I feel about the Wraith King on top of the Bristleback. That seems like maybe a little bit too much emphasis on the sustain. And Wraith King is, again, another hero who's very susceptible to mana drain, just because he needs 140 mana for reincarnation. If he doesn't go for a Soul Ring, which isn't very popular at this level of play, a Silencer can really punish him for just being around.
The mana's a good point, but I do like the Wraith King pickup. Maybe not the Wraith King and the Bristleback, but Wraith King seems really good, because he can run in, he can maybe force out a Global Silence if this game goes late. Even as a support, you're going to be pretty strong at 40 minutes on Wraith King because of his ability to just disappear into the jungle and also find those kills with the Blink Dagger early. And then they're going to have to kill him, and they might even have to use the Global Silence to do so they can actually focus on the Wraith King. And then he just respawns and kills everybody.
Yeah, so I like the Wraith King, and I like the Bristleback. I don't know how I feel about them paired up. You're very melee heavy.
I would agree with that.
You know, it's just right now their Union Gaming is sitting on a single ranged hero, and presumably that's not going to be a support. That looks like, well, it probably will end up a support if we do have that Brewmaster going mid. That's interesting too.
I would think it would be a support.
I feel like in this sort of lineup, they might have wanted to throw that Skywrath Mage in for a more level intensive position, because he's their only significant burst damage, and they're going to want to be able to remove the Shadow Shaman before he gets off those Serpent Wards. They're going to want to be able to remove the Necrophos before he gets off the Reaper's Scythe. They probably won't be able to take out the Silencer before Global Silence, so wouldn't really worry about that. Earthshaker's probably going to get a blink and come in with Echo Slam to open the fight, so probably wouldn't worry too much about that. But Shadow Shaman and Necrophos are susceptible to burst damage. And you would expect, if we have only one source of burst damage, we want to make sure that it is up and running as quickly as possible.
Yeah, and Skywrath and Brewmaster are actually pretty good at killing Necro. The other two heroes, not as much, because Necro, he's an interesting hero. He's going to build into the mech early, if he's a core hero. It's kind of hard to tell what they want to do right now. I don't really know what the Silencer is going to be, but I think Necro should be farming, and he's going to look to go for early armor, because it just makes your effective HP that much better if you've got early armor plus your flat heal. It scales really, really well up into maybe the 20-30 minute mark of the game. But Brewmaster and Skywrath should be able to burst through that quickly with the Arcane Bolt and the Mystic Flare. So he's definitely going to be their target. Silencer's pretty squishy. We'll see what Earthshaker could get done, or even where that hero's going to go. We've seen this hero take on a new shape in Dota 2. He's farming middle. He's farming safe lanes. He's a support.
The Crit Shaker.
The Crit Shaker. So Sneaky Nyx Assassin, their lineup is maybe a little bit ambiguous, but I'm a Necro believer, so... we've got that new feature coming to Dota where you can taunt if you think you're going to win the game. If I was on Sneaky Nyx Assassins, I would be taunting right now.
I think Necrophos mid actually has a lot of potential here if the Brewmaster is suspected to go mid. Against melee heroes one-on-one, the Heartstopper aura is very effective. And that on top of the Death Pulse means that Necrophos would probably not have very much trouble in
against
way
Brew.
Of lane control. Against Brew. If it's Skywrath, you don't want to do it. So it is a little bit risky. Up against Skywrath... I don't know that they really have a very strong mid laner against Skywrath. They can throw the Silencer up, but Skywrath has a very spammable arc.
They're not going to miss Sky. There's no way.
Yeah. I don't suspect they will either, but if they were to farm the Brewmaster and then throw the Skywrath into the mid lane, get a ranged support right here, I don't know the Sneaky Nyx Assassins really have a strong response in the laning phase.
I don't know. I just...
Wow.
Death Prophet. What? These are some interesting drafts.
Yeah.
So the pocket pushing hero, I guess, coming off for Death Prophet, there's already two heroes that push really well, Necro and Shadow Shaman. And I honestly... Sniper with Shrapnel is pretty good at just sieging down some towers. So 2.5 good pushing heroes on Sneaky Nyx Assassins to the 1, and Citadel picks up the Death Prophet, so that should be in the mid lane. That means a support Wraith King looks like an offlane Bristleback.
Yeah.
Benhaz has taken up a new role in the 1 position, so it looks like you were right. They'll be... farming up the Brewmaster, but I think levels are so much more important than the early items on Brewmaster.
Well, if they do strong with zoning, and they do strong with
pulling, and the supports don't steal the XP.
Right, so the Skywrath has a huge range for zoning out the opponent and heroes, so he's going to actually be only probably getting about half the experience that the Brewmaster is getting anyway, so he's going to be on the edge of experience just trying to force the Sneaky Nyx Assassin's back, specifically the offlaner, which is going to be Mike on the Sniper.
I'm thinking solo safe, maybe, and they go aggressive. I mean, Mike is definitely one to invent the offlane, and we can kind of give him credit to the offlane Faceless Void.
Yeah.
Damn you, IX Mike. So we'll see what he does on the Sniper. If he buys boots, then he's just straight up offlane. He goes Wraith Band,
I think he's going straight up offlane, maybe an aggressive try with the Sniper, but I think it's straight up off. This is something that you see actually in the kind of lower level pub, like the much lower MMR bracket that I typically play, and you see the offlane Sniper attempted quite frequently because of the range. If it's a heavy melee lane, it can be very successful. Unfortunately for Mike, this is a double ranged hero lane that he's up against, one of whom is a Skywrath Mage, so I don't know how successful he's going to be here. He does have a ward. He's going in right now to try and block that camp, but I don't think he's going to make it there in time. He's not even going to block the camp. He's just going
to... I would just say, most people don't even block the camps anymore. It's not
Mike
really
loves
worth
to block
it.
The camp. Mike almost always blocks the camp. Like, wow. Right there is... Right there is, like, Mike's bread and butter.
Yeah, down there on the lesser-known sides that are a little maybe often missed when trying to deward. But he puts that down there, just wants to see the support rotations, and he does. There actually are no sentries in this lane. I think the courier is maybe bringing them out now. Yes, it is. We'll see if they can go ahead and deward that, and I guess we should introduce the teams. We'll start with you in gaming. We got Xander on the Wraith King, supporting up alongside Jericho. We'll be playing the Skywrath Mage, farming down here in the bottom lane. They actually did a little swap there off the draft screen, so it's going to be Benhaz that finds himself on the Death Prophet in the safe lane. I think that makes much more sense. Citadel on the middle lane on the Brewmaster, because he really needs an XP as a hero, so we can get started earlier and hopefully fall off later. And then Angel offlane on the Bristleback.
So... on the Sneaky Nyx Assassins, we do have Snaw taking up that Silencer in the mid lane. It is going to be Ike's Mike, as we already mentioned, on the Sniper. And Fluff and Stuff is coming down here to block with that Earthshaker.
Yeah.
And now he's going to be rotating back up toward the mid lane. Up in the top lane, we do have Lust, the newest addition to this team, on the Shadow Shaman. And Ush is going to be taking that farming Necrophos. Let's talk a little bit about that hero swap, because that's something we don't see teams do that often anymore, but it's a really effective tactic when you have these very flexible drafts. Having two heroes chosen by players that could ostensibly be playing them, and then swapping them once you get in the game so your opponents don't know which player is playing which hero.
Yeah, which, I mean, only works in situations like this. I mean, Unigaming and the Sneaky Nyx Assassins, they play each other a lot. They study each other, I'm sure. If they're taking this serious, which they probably should be. And, yeah, so they know the players, they know their roles, and that can get into people's heads. But, I mean, if you're just doing that in your random pubs 5v5,
right.
You know, it's really pointless. But, yeah, it is a good point.
But at this level play, it makes a big difference. Like before Alliance came in TI3 and just did the same exact strategy every single game, this was very commonplace. When, back in the No Tidehunter days where you had, like, No Tidehunter mouse running across Europe, they would almost always swap heroes, almost every single game. That you would watch, you would see two heroes that could go one farming, one mid, and then you'd see them swap at least a support in or something to try and throw off their opponents. You don't see it as much anymore, but it's really effective because this Brewmaster could very easily have been shut down, I think, by a Necropost mid.
Up top, oh, this could be the first blood up top. There's a Fisher. Lust is might be the one who dies, and he does die. Now Ash trying to spam out the heal, but he also goes down. Angel getting a double kill off of this. So that has went terribly wrong for the Sneaky Nyx Assassins. I was just about to say, Necro's an okay hero versus Bristleback just because he does always wither him down anytime he's facing him with the Heartstopper aura. But at level 2, you don't normally have it. From what I noticed, Mason, when he played Necro a couple times at TI4, he went 1 in Death Pulse, 1 in Heartstopper aura. And then got Sadist either level 3 or 4, depending on the game. But not the case here with Ush. He's looking for a little bit of lane sustain. And it's hard to criticize Ush. He was probably one of the biggest standout players during the TI4 qualifiers, of all of the qualifiers in any region. Right. So he does go down to Angel.
An extremely valuable player. And in the mid lane, we are going to see rotation coming out of Fluff and stuff very soon. He's waiting on the high ground for an opportunity. There is no mana on Cinderellin as well, because of the Curse of the Silent, which just wrecks a Brewmaster so significantly. He's so dependent on Bottle right now in this mid lane. That, honestly, if Fluff is just going to be waiting around anyway, he might as well come back around and wait on this high ground to get that Courier when it comes in, because you know the Brewmaster is going to be running that Bottle very soon.
They're going to maybe try to look for a kill here. There is a very, very nice block, so Citadel's going to have to run south here through the river. Are they going to be able to bring him down, though? Is there enough damage? Snaw, that's going to do only about 150. Yeah, it's 150 at level 1. If it was one level higher, it maybe could have been a kill. And actually, looking at the bottom lane, IX Mike in a bit of trouble. Xanders has sort of backstabbed the tower here. We'll throw out a Wraithfire Blast, stuns him, and the slow, harassing him down a bit. So Mike up to level 3. Obviously, that very first Earthshaker block got him to level 2 immediately. So that was basically the intention with that. You can no longer pull him to the Ancients, which would have actually been awesome. And actually, we see Xander some tricks up his sleeve. Going to try to kill Mike at the Ancients. Maybe even get the Ancients to do some damage. And this could be the third blood here. Unfortunately, those Ancients are just mainly attacking him. And he's going to run down IX Mike. He's going to try to get himself denied here to the Ancients. Can he? No, the Arcane Bolt up the hill. Jericho will get the kill. And you don't see kills like that very often. That was something special.
That was a very nice play coming out of Union Gaming. They know if this is going to be an offlane sniper, they know that this is a very important Ancient stack for him. I guess it's just a single stack right now, but it's a very important Ancient pool for him.
Well, it's blocked already.
Right. He doesn't know that, I don't think, though, because that is, I think, the first time that he rotated back. He might have rotated back one other time, but I think he's been forced either into lane or away from the Ancients every time he's tried to stack.
And that ward's fresh. It's only been there for 30 seconds.
Yeah, so as far as he knows, he can stack right now. And the shrapnel, it does affect towers. It also impacts Ancients, I'm fairly certain, which means that is where the sniper is trying to get his experience from, or is he just trying to use his range?
I don't know if it hits the big black dragon. Yeah, it does hit buildings. I'm not sure if it hits the bigger of the Ancients, but it does hit some of the smaller ones. So I guess it's still worth it to try to get it. And maybe it does hit all of them. I mean, that's got to be one of the reasons for maybe even putting an offlane sniper in the first place, because it's not something you see every day. It's actually not something you see very often at all, except maybe in some pubs, of which this isn't.
He is not using shrapnel on these, so I guess that is not the...
It will work on the smaller Black Dragons, because everything does, but it's not going to work on some of the bigger ones, and I think it'll work on the smaller Thunderhides, but not the bigger one, which does make some really weird noises, I might add.
Yeah, well, even if you're just knocking down the smaller ones, you can auto-attack the bigger ones and just kind of whittle down the whole stack at one time. So yeah,
looks like he's just sort of kiting them back and farming them from the high ground, trying to get some experience off of these, because they do give a decent amount. But to check out some of the other lanes, in the mid lane, we've got that interesting matchup as Angel diving people up top, so we might have to hold that thought, and the Death Pulse is chasing him down. That's a bit of a bad effect. The Death Pulse is so slow. I think if Necro was to get buffed one more time, they'd maybe increase the travel speed of his Death Pulse, because a lot of heroes later on in the game will just regen so much health by the time they run that they'll never die anyways. So
right.
I don't know. But actually, another smoke here in the bottom lane. They're looking for IX Mike, and they've got up on the high ground. This is so funny. He has no idea because he can't see up those little stairs, and they're gonna bring him down again. IX Mike will die. Not even in the lane. They just know what he's up to, and they're shutting this down.
Yeah, this is why this offlane sniper at the beginning of the game
is
like,
not a thing.
Yeah, this is why you don't see it at very high levels of play typically. It's also why both Healy and I were kind of hedging our bets on it being a good idea, especially against the Skywrath Mage. There's just nothing that he's going to be able to do. They're also going to lose this bottom tower if they don't get some rotations very shortly. And the level's already out for Death Prophet for that level 6, so tower has immediately started to drop down.
Yeah, that could actually be good for Sniper, though, if they just decide to push the tier 1 and then sort of go to other lanes and try to help out. Because what I wanted to do was look at mid. We see 27 last hits, 3 denies for the Brewmaster. It's actually Sniper who is winning this lane. It's hard to, you know, get dominance if you don't have enough mana to use any of your spells on Brewmaster, and he hasn't had really the opportunity. Earthshaker's also been helping out a little bit. But Snarl's winning that lane. Death Prophet farming the most on the map, 45 and 21, and then up top, the first blood double kill for Angel on top of 33 last hit, so he's doing very, very well. Necro a little bit behind that, 26 and 6, so Ush is doing okay.
Yeah, this is nice for Sneaking Assassins at this point in time. They have at least gotten some vision back up, because bear in mind, all of their wards were counter warded like right away at the beginning of this game. So not only has Mike been playing up against a double range, he's been playing up against a Skywrath, but he's also been playing up against them with no vision, because the Sneaking Assassins put both of their vision on the lower side of this map. Up top, Angel dives, and he is going to be shackled in. He will
tower hit
and
attack. Yeah, he gets him.
Alright.
That's pretty big. 7.5 minutes. Lust is almost level 6, so actually will hit level 6 off of this wave. So they give up some kills. They're down 4 right now. But they're really getting... They have the weaker lanes, and they knew that coming into this draft. So they're not really expecting to win them. If they get level 6 on that Shadow Shaman, and then really start to take objectives off the map, that's when I think the Sniper can find some time to catch up. Snaw's already doing very well. He's winning his lane. Citadel tries to dive him, and he gets shut down. So losing the lanes, down 4 kills, but I think maybe 10 or 12 minutes into this game is when the Nyx Assassins, or maybe when the mech just comes up on Necro, which he is actually quite far from, is when they group up and start to take down objectives.
Yeah, this is not really going on the pace that Nyx Assassins wanted. They wanted to be the first ones to push down a tower, but the Death Prophet up against the Sniper, it looks like they're going to lose a tower before they get one. Unless they all group up very, very shortly here. I don't know that the Nyx Assassins are going to be able to grab that first tower and get that surge of gold to try and springboard off of. They do smoke up and move into their opponent's jungle, where they are going to find a Wraith King. So Wraith King is stunned out with the Fissure. He's only level 5, but immediately Jericho comes in with the Silence, throwing out the Arcane Bolt. Another one about to come out. A little bit of a body block coming out of Jericho, stopping Zinderels from getting in for that stun, but it does not matter. The Silence goes out, and the TP will bring back Snaw to safety.
Yeah, nicely done. I mean, when you look at all, let's say Brewmaster, let's say if Brewmaster used his Primal Split to survive right there, we'd be saying, oh, it's not really worth it. That's not a great first use of Primal Split. So I think it's fair to say the same towards the Silencer. 130 second cooldown, that kind of controls whether you can take team fights or not. And he uses it just to escape and live there, which means they're also going to give up this bottom tier 1 tower, or at least they should be. There's 2 points in the aura here from Xander's, and yeah, the tower goes down. Shrapnel to try to slow down the push a little bit, and there's an Earthshaker stomp. They want to try to kill somebody. Xander's should die to that last ward, will die to the last ward, and he's only level 5. So the second kill of the game for the Sneaky Nyx Assassins, we've got one on Lust and one on Snaw.
I want to point out that was a really nice deny coming out of this IX Mike. This tower was denied out, so really doesn't end up being that painful for the Assassins. This is a tower. This offlane Brewmaster getting a kill on the Necrophos.
Man, that first level of Reaper's Scythe is so underwhelming. 0.4 damage per missing health point, so even though Bristleback's pretty low, he does not get the kill.
Yeah, it's magical damage, not pure damage, so you're looking at 0.4 minus 25% on most heroes. So it's basically a stun at level one. Yeah, it does a little bit of damage, but unless they're essentially going to die anyway, or just about to get out of sight, it is completely underwhelming, you're right. And if Necrophos were on the docket for getting a buff, I think that changing that from magical to pure might be one of the ways to do it.
Yeah, I was actually just glancing at the chat, and they're on the 2-minute, and I saw someone write, Necro needs a buff, he's already so broken. And I was like, this guy gets it. I honestly think Necro is an insanely good hero. Maybe Bristleback's not the easiest lane, but it's not really the easiest lane for any hero in the game. And to speak more about Reaper's Scythe, that ability is honestly there just to KS. And there's an invis rune, there's a thunderclap onto three, they're going to stun up Snaw and bring him down immediately. His global silence had 5 seconds on cooldown, couldn't have got it off anyway. They cyclone up IX Mike here, looking for another boulder coming out from the pandas, and they get it, and he will go down. Brewmaster going to take that kill. Lust decides to show up, probably just to die. They can't tornado him in time, and there is no blink yet here on Citadel. He's just got phase bottle and a full magic wand, but he's very close to that blink, and they're going to chase down Lust really no problem. They're not really pushing objectives right now, they're just getting kills, but it shouldn't really matter. And actually Fluff and Stuff also still running away, and there is a soul ring on this Wraith King, so 10 more seconds they can go ahead and kill him, or just an arcane bolt and some attacks. Everyone's so out of mana right now, except for Fluff. Now he's completely out. One more Fissure goes off. He will drop in, and this should be a kill and some more intelligence now coming out for Snaw. If not two kills, there's one and another one coming out. One more attack should do it, or just a Curse of the Silent. He gets it. So 4 intelligence over to Snaw, and I gotta say that's not worth it. Just to kill an Earthshaker, you've made the Silencer so much stronger. He's now got 6 stolen intelligence to his name.
Not only are you making him stronger, you're making yourselves weaker. This is...
Yeah, that's true.
This is relative gain of like 8, right? So I really don't understand why the Wraith King uses Soul Ring to throw out the Wraith Fire Blast there. Maybe you can explain that to me. Maybe you see what he saw. He was running downhill, which means that the Silencer is still going to have vision, and the Soul Ring is just enough mana for him to use his ultimate. So
I mean, it was pretty close to getting away. And also, sometimes, I mean, let's say it's not against a Silencer where you're giving him stats and losing your own, but dying with that 5-minute cooldown on your alt is actually a really, really big deal. So sometimes it's better to be out of mana and just die as opposed to putting that on a 5-minute cooldown, because that also controls whether or not you can fight. And Brewmaster's ult is down right now, Wraith King's is up, so if Xander's wants to go back in and initiate now, they can try to stop this Roshan. So in the long run, I think it's better that the Reincarnation is left available.
Yeah, well, it is certainly helping them right here, as they are just...
Oh,
just
Mike!
See you later, Mike.
We got feeder alert, Mike. 0, 4, and 1. That's all right. This is how progress is made, though. Soon, TI5 offlane sniper is probably going to be the number one pick and ban. Dire's
middle tower. Yeah, this is... The sniper is not a hero who catches up very well, and that's the biggest issue with him in the offlane, I think. It's not that he's fragile, which he is. It's not that he gets outclassed a lot of times against 2 or 3 heroes, which he does early game. It's that he doesn't have anywhere to go if he doesn't do well in the lane. Unlike a Bristleback, who can just go farm anywhere, literally. Or unlike
a Dro, I think, is a good example, who can jungle as soon as she's level 6 with no items. Like, she can just catch up there. Sniper really can't do anything, but maybe try to KS with Assassinate.
Right, maybe try to get a little bit of gold catch-up by sitting on the outside of fights and throwing out the Assassinate once in a while. But for the most part, he doesn't have any AoE. He doesn't have great attack damage, honestly, early on in the game.
Oh, another Primal Split. Looking for 2 more kills, at least 1. Lust is not living through this. The Global Silence goes out. That will silence all of the Brulings, and yeah, Lust will fall. But that, nope. Tornado goes up and will cancel it. Immediately purged off so that Bristle can dive this before more TPs come in, and I think they will just back off. Ush completely out of mana, though, so he's fairly useless right now. Fluff is up with a nice Fissure block, and IX Mike trying to get in those attacks, get those headshots, and it's a kill. Another 2 intellect over to Snaw himself.
Yeah, this is all right for Nyx. I mean, as long as they're not losing ground, they're gaining ground at this stage in the game. They are over 10,000 gold in deficit, though, and 7,500 experience at 14 minutes. That's ooh, the big global silence is going to be used here. The assassinate out. It's not going to finish him, though. Oh, he actually loses sight.
No, that doesn't matter. I think he just canceled it.
Did he just cancel? Why?
Yeah.
With the silencer throwing out that Curse of Silent, I mean, it would have been
close. Yeah, that would have been pretty close. 355 damage, like, that is not... that was kill range, I think, even with some mitigation of the damage.
I'm actually going to check what silencer, or what the Skywrath was at real quick, so fill some time while I'm figuring that out. Skywrath got down to 265 there.
That was not a lot of time to fill.
Yeah. Sometimes the combat log is a little wonky during live games, and yeah, it takes a little while to load up. So, but right, another offlane tower going down here for the Nyx Assassins, which means that they have lost all of their primary Roshan.
They've got Exorcism available. So they're going to look to go to the high ground. Benjaz is going to stand as close to that tower as possible, because I'm sure this man reads the Reddit. He's also got the Aegis of the Immortal online, so this is going to be the first 2-3 tower of the game. It should be falling. There is no fortification. It was already used, so 15 and a half minutes into the game, losing your 2-3, that's not too good. There's a really good Fisher that maybe they can capitalize from, and yeah, they will kill Angel. They don't quite get him with the Reaper Scythe. That's Benhaz going down, but keep in mind, he does have the Aegis Ush to fall right now, and this Death Prophet gonna respawn. Does not have Exorcism, though. Throws out the Silence onto Lust. Lust not able to do too much, but will bring down the Skywrath Mage. Hellfire Blast goes out from Xander. That's gonna pick up a kill there. Then the Fisher and an Assassinate not gonna be needed, and that's the Gem of True Sight that was just purchased, taking a fall. So, your Tier 3 tower is down, but honestly, every time Benhaz and his team come here, just drop the Serpent Wards, and voila, you've got something better than a Tier 3 tower, as long as it's available. So Benhaz escapes. They use a lot to push up there, and they don't do anything. A little bit of damage on the melee racks, but that's obviously going to be repaired in not too long.
This is really going to hurt the Nyx Assassin's ability to push, though, because they do want to make sure that they have the Serpent Wards available defensively at this stage. They're so far behind that they honestly will be very hard-pressed to win a team fight without those on this high ground. So they're not going to be too eager to drop those on towers, which means that their tower push is going to get slowed down pretty significantly, as that was their primary pushing strategy up to this point. The Sniper and Necrophos just are not synergizing very well this game, partially because Sniper is so back and underfed. I mean, he's got a Bracer and an Aquila, and that's
all.
Hey,
he just finishes treads, right?
Yeah. So
he's trying.
I mean, he's doing what he can. That is compared to Angel in that offlane, sitting as a more traditional offlaner with the Bristleback at Blade Mail and Mechanism, plus Treads and Bottle and Wand. All just said and done, and I'm pretty sure Angel's sitting on top of, about 500 gold as well. So, Sniper is way behind where he needs to be. He also does not flash farm as quickly as Angel will. So, very difficult time for IX Mike to even make himself relevant in this game. Like, I don't know what he can possibly do at this stage to really make himself known on this team.
Yeah, I mean, he is a 3-roll, just an offlane hero, so he doesn't have to do maybe all that much. However, I can think of a lot of offlane heroes that'd be having way more of an impact right now. So we'll see what he can do. Actually, everyone's pretty far behind. Ush, just now, finishes his mechanism at 17 minutes and 50 seconds. For a safe lane farming Necro, you want that coming up at like 10 or 12, along with some treads. And did he actually? No, he actually went phase boots. I mean, the hero is slow as molasses, but I do like the extra tankiness and, of course, the tread swapping efficiency that you can get a lot out of on that hero. Like, you kill things, your Sadis kicks in, then you switch to agility treads, so you regen your health and mana that much more efficiently. Then every time you cast, you go back to intelligence. Every time you fight, of course, you're going to stay on strength. And I think you can get so much out of that, but does go for the phase.
I agree. I think the treads work better on that hero, especially if you go treads for staff. And then you have the maneuverability that you would have if you had the phase boots anyway. You also have the defensive capabilities of a force staff. You have the extra intelligence and mana pool that comes with that. And then you have the ability to swap your treads to maximize the efficacy of those death pulses, which, as you had already mentioned, makes him a very difficult hero to kill.
Yeah. I don't know. I still think mech has got to be your first core item, and we actually do see that Silencer went back and picked up a four staff. He did have the point booster beforehand, so he was thinking, hey, I want to rush Ags. It's going to devastate this team. A full, 7-second silence at rank 3 with the scepter, plus your current rank of Curse of the Silent. So that's going to drain most of their mana. That's going to take away the Wraith King ult. It's going to take away the spammy Quill Spray coming out from Angel. Maybe even going to stop a Brewmaster ult, but he does have quite a bit of stats. Not too much mana, though. Anyone phase, so that really could mitigate most of the team fight once they finish that Ag. So as long as Nyx can hold on, Lust in the mid lane able to TP out. Wow.
Yeah, the one shining light for Nyx Assassins right now is that the Brewmaster does fall off. And he falls off. He'll probably fall off in this game in, I would say, 15, because he is going to be able to get that Ags up very quickly.
He's pretty far ahead, and Nyx is pretty far behind.
So 10, 15 minutes, he's not going to be quite as scary, although he is going to be dodging and critting like a monster. So he by fall off, we don't typically mean as casters. He becomes irrelevant. We mean he doesn't become the complete monster that he is now. Like, he becomes manageable. The Death Prophet is very difficult to kill in the late game. I think she as a hero is undervalued for the late game. Just because
Yule's OP, man.
Yeah. Her ability to just kind of stand without being able to be attacked while damaging everything around her and healing up once that Yule's comes out is pretty ridiculous. Alongside the Blood Zone, so she does respawn quickly. She might go into a heart as well, though usually you see players choose one or the other. There's going to be a smoke attempt coming out of the Nyx Assassins moving in toward this high ground. Angel finds himself a Snaw, and I don't know that this is an engagement that the Nyx Assassins really want. The Fisher's going to keep Snaw on the wrong side of the tracks.
What a Fisher.
That was very nice separation, and it will actually end up saving Snaw, and possibly the entire Nyx Assassins team. So very strong play coming out of Fluff and stuff. Recognizing that was not
forced out an Exorcism away from the tower, so this is going to run out pretty much by the time they get to that high ground here in the middle lane, if they even want to push afterwards. And I think maybe they're just going to back off, which could potentially give us some time. We did kind of just cover a lot of the items on a lot of the heroes, but to just look at it all, we got a Blink Dagger now at Sidorol on the Brewmaster. We got a Blink Treads on Xander. He's looking for a Blade Mail of his own, it would appear. Another gem on Jericho. It looks like I think they got it back. The Yule Scepter Bloodstone on Benhaz. We've got a Mechanism and a Blade Mail on Angel's Bristleback. Aghanim Scepter, how close are we? A little more than halfway, point booster, 700 gold in the bank, and an Ogre Club, so he's not too far off from that. Just needs a little bit more farm, and then maybe Nyx can finally start to take some fights. This Sniper can catch up, because Sniper currently sitting on Aquila Treads and just a Bracer, trying to tank up, really, so nothing. And then you got a Medallion of Courage here on Lust, because obviously that's just looking to maybe bring down one of those tanky heroes a bit faster, but I think more specifically just to do Roche with that dire advantage, which they were unable to do on their first attempt, but maybe taking away this middle tier 1 tower will give them some more space, some more map control, and they can take that next Roshan. But Lust is going to be brought down. No! Yeah, he's going to die. That Arcane Bolt is unreal. Yeah. Maybe not with the bottle. Barely going to live. 157 damage, and they will force out the ultimate here. Reincarnation now going to be on cooldown for 160 seconds after that assassinate.
I don't know that the 160 seconds is as big of a deal at this stage in the game, because the UG is completely controlling the pace of this game. Like, anytime that they want to fight, they can make a fight happen. And anytime they don't want to fight, they can sack a tower, and it doesn't really hurt them that much. I mean, they look at the gold lead. They have steadily continued to rise. Like, the experience lead shows the ebb and flow of the way team fights have been going. And the Nyx Assassins have been jumping back and forth between 7,500 and 5,000 for a while. But gold, they have barely made a dent in the upward progress that UG has been making. And UG will be at 20,000 by 25 minutes at this pace.
Well, this pace should stop, right? Because now you've got to break high ground, and if you don't break high ground, this line's probably just going to even out, because Nyx is getting a lot of farm just funneled into their base. Granted, they're all stuck in their base. We've got to support Wraith King farming up the enemy jungle, so he's taking out the farm there. Everyone's stuck in the base. They just need to get this the Aghanim Scepter here on to Snaw, and then after they do that, if they can take a fight and then start to take over map control, secure another Roche, and then start to bring down some towers, which are really just bags of gold waiting to be taken, they can start to bring this back to equilibrium and maybe bring this game back, but
this is potentially not the way to do it, though. Fluff and stuff are going to be silenced out. He's going to go have that mech thrown up. Nice. Very nice force is going to keep him out of the Skywrath ultimate, but Cinderellin is going to come in and finish that off. Now Lust on chopping block. He's being moved in on by Benhaz, who also has his ultimate going. Snaw is taking a fair amount of damage here and is also silenced out by that Skywrath mage. This should be Rax and could very well be game. There's the ultimate coming out of the Pandaren Brewmaster as well, and the stun. Thunderclap coming down onto Ush. Now, Mike really doesn't have any chance of getting away here. This is, going to be Rax. These Serpent Wards are going to be farmed up as well. So now we should be at the 20,000 gold lead once this chart updates. Just from this.
I don't know, man. Never count out the Sniper buyback. Let's see what IX Mike can get done here. There's Serpent Wards, there's an IX Mike, and there's a Fluff and stuff. Will friendship prevail over the pushing Death Prophet, Wraith King, and Brewmaster now blinking forward? Nyx looks like he will die back here. Poor IX Mike. They're going to Cyclone up. That's just a Yule Scepter Cyclone, as the ultimate for Sidorol was already used, and they will clean him up. And that might actually just prompt the GG here from the Sneaky Nyx Assassins. And to quote Nahaz earlier from the Twitch chat, he was trying to pretend that he was the thoughts of the Sneaky Nyx Assassin, saying, let's just make this game as hard as possible. We'll pick Sniper and Necro.
Yeah, those two heroes, they just don't... I mentioned this earlier, but I didn't really go into depth on it, but they don't really synergize well, because they both do the same thing with their ultimates, right? They both come in, arguably steal, some would say secure kills, on single targets. But they're also both kind of staggered timing ultimates. They can't really sync them up together very easily. So if you have Ush moving in on a target that he wants to gank, you have Mike coming in on a target that he wants to gank as well, it's really difficult for them to kind of line that up and actually make their ultimates synergize. So you've got two single target ultimates that require assistance from other sources of damage. Like, we're not talking a Skywrath Mage, Mystic Flare. That is the bulk of the damage that's going to be done. These ultimates are securement ultimates, and you have too much securing and not enough actually doing the work. You know, too much management and not enough labor. Makes for a very difficult business.
I forgot how good Fluff's Earthshaker was. These fishers are unreal. They're just like sitting there baiting Lost, looking to block off. Maybe they separate someone big on the team and they can find a kill, but it doesn't work out. But again, to harp on those ultimates, I would say Snipers is kill steeled. Necro's is kill secured. Necro, his ability, that his ultimate is literally built in so that he takes the kills, because if Necro takes the kills, you win the team fights. It's like a free heart when you have Sadus max and you get a kill. A free heart for mana as well as HP. So it's unreal. Heart and a Bloodstone, I guess, if we want to call it that. But the bottom racks have still not fallen. As bad as that last fight was with the Forest, the diebacks, they did not get the racks because of the good placement by the Serpent Wards here in front
UG
of
played greedy
the
too.
Racks. So,
they dove in for hero kills instead of farming out the wards and then getting the racks, which...
Another great Fissure block. Look at this. How can you push when there's just a wall that you can't get through?
This is why we were seeing, I think it was TI, but it might have been TI qualifiers. There was a whole spree where we saw instant ban on the Earthshaker because there were so many Fissure blocks on a couple of games that bought enough time for teams to come back. And Nyx Assassins are not going to have that opportunity right now.
Yeah, they will try to focus now. Global Silence goes out, so he's not silenced himself. I think there was a pair of Force Staffs used there on Snaw as they try to bring him down. And will they even be able to? Yes, Wraithfire Blast is going to do it. Xander still has his ult, but not enough mana. Soul Ring on cooldown. Someone's ward trapped. It looks like, no, just a Brooding. And Ush himself is in his own wards, trapped up. And there's a kill there. That's going to drop the gem. Skywrath goes down. Xander will pick up the gem. Now has mana for his ult, so maybe looking to die here. Yeah, he does die. Ush trying to go in, scurrying on in slowly. A little quicker than normal with his phase boots. And he did go for a four staff afterwards, so true mobility on that hero. This was a buyback, however, onto Ush. But they do preserve the racks.
Comes in and they play a little greedy. They dove all the way over to here trying to secure heroes instead of just all they have to do is Brewmaster split and sick them on the racks and it will go down. Like, they will be able to clear up that much damage with just one Brewmaster ulti. Wraith King is
I don't know what they're doing. I don't know why they don't just kill the racks, but I guess they got blood in their eyes.
Yeah, maybe it's a grudge match of some kind. And the Nyx Assassins are happy to let them continue to take two for two up here instead of getting the racks, because They haven't called GG, so they still feel like they might be in this. Although they are now 2,500 gold in deficit. Taking a look at the net worth, the top four are for UG. The Skywrath Mage is the only hero that doesn't have a net worth higher than the bulk of Nyx, if not all of Nyx.
And he honestly doesn't need one, because even as at his current state, he can 1v1 pretty much anyone on the other team if he gets that initiation, or at least his silence first. He needs to get his silence on the silencer, and it's pretty good. I like Skywrath. He is a hero with that 6-second silence that honestly kind of counters Doom, because if you can get that 6-second silence off in the early game on Doom, then he can't Doom anyone on silencer, he can't use his global silence. It's kind of funny, but obviously later on when there's BKBs and Mantis on the field, Ancient Seal isn't quite as good, and looks like the second Roche is also going to go over to Union Gaming, and with this, maybe they'll be a little more cautious and actually just push down some buildings instead of delaying this game out even further than I think it needs to be, because honestly, probably could have been over.
Oh, it definitely could have been over. If Union Gaming had been playing objective-based instead of blood in their eyes, they would have had this game already. And this is probably going to be the moment where they actually come in. Nope, Ben Haas is immediately going to abandon the racks throughout the global silence. There's Zinderels charging in as well. The Brewmaster ulti being used to attack down heroes as well. No heroes down yet. They're trying to kite. Now the turnaround back onto the racks as everybody's been forced back to the fountain from the Nyx Assassins. They're just going to wait out this ultimate from the Death Prophet, finally giving up that racks. The Blinken coming out, and an additional stun is going to miss, but does not matter. The Necrophos is going to be going down. Now Ben Haas is going to charge all the way back into the pound and try to block off Fluff and Stuff before he can get in, but the body blocks are not there. Fluff and Stuff will be able to get into the safety of his fountain. Though, one could argue, at the point in time in a game where you are mad rushing toward the safety of your fountain as a team, maybe it's time to consider GG.
Yeah, I mean, it's just a two-game series. I guess the Knicks Assassins are going to stick it out and see what their heroes can do, I guess, even when this far behind. But with the death there on Snod, there's not a buyback available on either of those heroes right now. Fluff and Stuff gets up a pretty decent ultimate, but it doesn't do anything. Serral gets a double kill. Ben Haas gets the Earthshaker there, and Fluff throws out the GG. I believe he is the in-game captain here for the Knicks Assassins. So he throws out the GG first. I don't know who was drafting. maybe it was just a Divine Courage draft or something. I have no idea. It was interesting. It maybe could have worked, but it's hard
Fluff
to offlane.
Fluff has been doing the drafting for the Knicks Assassins since he joined, so I suspect it was a Fluff draft. But they are a team that likes experiment, so and we see that.
It's pretty hard to offlane any hero against a Skywrath, let alone a Sniper. And I like the idea of what they're trying to do. Like, hey, let's get Sniper level 2. We can get into his extra range ability. Maybe he can kite around the Ancients and whatnot, but it did not work out. They shut that down, the Skywrath and the Wraith King entirely. They shut it down. So well played by Uni Gaming, a bit sloppy at the end, but hey, I don't really think there was any possibility of them losing this game. And, anyways, I'm Helium. You can follow me on Twitter at HeliumBrella, Gorgon on Twitter at GotCalDota. And any final words from you before we head into game 2?
Hey, no, just stick around for game number 2, because this is a 2-game series here at the JDL Season 3. Thanks for tuning in.
All right, peace.